Sorry, I couldn't resist on the introduction.
Yeah.
Lorne Peterson, who's a long-time employee of ILM, we'll talk a little bit about the Star Wars 4, 5, and 6, which was actually the 1, 2, and 3 movies that you've seen. Some of my favorites,
yeah.
Actually.
When we were doing it, we were calling them 1, 2, and 3, but...
Did George Lucas know at that point that he was going to do a nonology of 9?
In some ways, you can have an idea for anything. I'm going to go to the moon or something like that. But unless the first one made money and the second one made money,
that's true.
It never would have happened that way. It had to be financially successful, or they never would have let him get near a camera again.
That's true.
Yeah.
So you had interesting beginnings even before Star Wars, before there was a Star Wars. And we found some slides.
I was going to say humble beginnings, and he said, no, they weren't humble.
I don't think they're so humble. So.
But I didn't pursue working on a film. It just really happened by accident. And prior to working on Star Wars, I was working for a contractor for McDonald's, and I was carving giant hamburgers that... I don't know if any of you are old enough to remember McDonald's parks, but besides McDonald's, there was the Hamburglar, and there was Mayor McCheese, and...
Grimace.
And who?
Grimace.
Yeah, Grimace, and the that hot apple pie turnover tree. So I was carving those things. I didn't have to reproduce them, fortunately, in fiberglass. I was just... took a big block of foam and with a chainsaw and knives and things like that, made them, but... That was what I was doing prior to. And
so I don't think that's so humble, because these things appeared probably in hundreds of places, too. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, true.
Yeah.
And I was checking to see how they were doing and on the project, and I came nose to nose with someone I went to college with, and he said, we're making a small film, science fiction film out in the valley. We could really use your help. We're having a hard time finding model makers. And... he said, can you do it? And I said, well, I don't know. Let me come and see. I wasn't like a super science fiction fan or anything like that. And, he said, I don't know. I was cautious at first, but boy, when I got there, I loved the designs and what was happening. It was like, I played hard to get, maybe financially, but a little bit hard to get. But, there was an interesting story that my boss at the time said, when you showed up was the best day of my life, or something like that. And I said, well, how come? He said, well, because you negotiated for more money than they were paying me, so they had to up my salary. And I thought, boy, that was a pretty good trick. He just instantaneously got a third more money or something like that.
So here's an early slide of Lorne at ILM. You can see he did a lot of carving of stuff.
Yeah, that's true. I was probably carving something. Since I'd carved those big hamburgers, I knew how to, if somebody puts a big block of something in front of you, I know how to get the hamburger out of that block of foam. So it applied. Applied for other things also.
So we have another slide. This is one of my favorite slides, although it's kind of low resolution. It shows you sort of amongst many of the things that you've done, not all of them.
Yeah,
but, it was. And participated in.
This was set up, I think, after Jedi, and it was for, I think, Time magazine wanted a picture of George Lucas standing in amongst all these models. And so, since George Lucas was going to be there, and then after he left, we all took the camera was all set up, and so we took our own pictures at the time. But that was not all the models from the first show, but kind of. A lot of them crammed in the
same.
Should
warn you, we're going to try and go through the movies sort of in order, but there's certain places where we're going to jump a little bit. Like when we get to the Star Destroyers, we want to show all the Star Destroyers together. So the people who are out there, when I say we're going to do A New Hope, and you go, oh, but that's from Return of the yes, we know.
Yeah.
So we'll jump a little bit.
Yeah.
But in general, we'll start off with the A New Hope, the first Star Wars movie.
We partly have to do that because the first show, we did not know that we were making Star Wars, the gigantic. We knew, third of the way through, halfway through, we knew that this was going to be a really good movie and a really fun movie, but no one could have conceived that a 10 and a half $11 million movie was going to make that much money. So it became gigantic after that. So there wasn't a still photographer on the first show. We each just used a camera to take pictures. So it isn't documented in the same way that the subsequent films were.
Of course, having said that, here's a nice documentary photograph of the crew.
Yeah, that was the first crew. And I think I've counted it, and there's about 75 people there or something. And at the very maximum, it was about 90 people. And I started when it was about 22 people. And I have to remind people that it wasn't a publicly held company, so I did not become a stockholder in the...
Too bad.
Yeah, too bad.
Can you spot Lorne?
What? Oh.
There he is.
Oh. I forgot about that part. You did that.
Yeah. So, yeah. Early model shop.
This was the model shop. Very, very crowded. We had only half a building, and we kept buying more and more. Not buying, but we would pay out a company that did furniture stripping or folded newspapers. And the first one we would, let's say they paid $10,000 for them to move and we would get their space. The next one wanted $20,000 because they'd heard that the first one got, as we moved further and further down the line of the building and rented out bays. But
it's Lorne right here, by the way.
It was very, very, it was very crowded, and we petitioned the company all the time that we needed more space.
This is probably a little later on, too, because...
I can tell. I spent so much time with those people. There's several people that I spent more time than their parents spent with them, you know, unless you count sleeping at the middle of the night. But in those years, we spent much time. And I can tell by the clothing. I know that's his shirt, and that's his shirt. And, you know, it's like the cycle of every 2 weeks a different shirt. That kind of thing.
You see the nice big 4-foot Millennium Falcon there standing up.
And a little tiny aside, you would think that why would a model shop have a carpet on the floor, because it just gets all junky and it's hard to vacuum. Well, there was no heat in the building the first winter time. And the producer, I'd said, you know, when are we going to get some heat? Because I started at the end of the summer heading towards 78 winter. And in Marin gets quite cold, as it does up here as opposed to L.A. So he said, well, we're only going to be here for 1 year. Couldn't you just go buy a bunch of those little heaters for under people's desks rather than paying for a heat to heat the whole building? So that was, it's hard to imagine a company as big as Lucasfilm saying we're not going to have any heat because we don't want to put that into the budget and go buy little heaters. But that's why we had carpet on the floor, because it was so cold, cement, and we had to take the towels and push underneath of the doors so the wind wouldn't blow up underneath.
Imagine it kept the parts from bouncing around, too.
What's that?
If you dropped the parts, it probably kept them from bouncing around, too.
Yeah.
So here's another one I just wanted. I've noticed in several of your slides you're wearing that T-shirt. So you must have cornered the market on Puma T-shirts.
Yeah, a number of people have commented on that, and I'd have to write back on the computer that I found in a used clothing store like 6 or 8 seconds shirts. You know, they had a little seam missing, and so I bought every single one of them. It wasn't that I was advertising Puma. But this was the first Star Wars. This was the model shop. The guy with the knees over on the left didn't want his picture taken at that time. But that was the, you know, seven model makers and about 78 employees. So it was done with a fairly small crew. And also, everybody was in their 20s. It was the youngest person was 19 years old, and the oldest, there was about two people that were 31, 32 years old. I think I was 29. But it was definitely a 20-year-old party. You know, we had dances on Friday night because we had lots of floor space. And you can see the speaker there, the guy that headed the shop up, the guy is with the knees, he went out and bought the biggest Yamaha speakers he could buy. We had a turntable. It was the Songs in the Key of Life by Stevie Wonder. It was a Rhiannon by Fleetwood Mac that would play over and over again. It was definitely young people's party.
Inside the shop. All right.
Oh yeah, yeah. We had huge speakers.
So this must have been a little bit later because there's a Imperial Walker there. Yeah, couple different sizes of them there.
Say it again.
A couple different sizes of Imperial Walkers.
Yeah. The thing about the both the Walkers and the Millennium Falcon, let's take the Walkers. Sometimes there'd be a Walker in the foreground, and you would make a Walker half that size that would only be 4 feet back. And then another 4 feet back, you'd make a Walker that was only 2.5 inches tall. And of course, to your eye, it would just look like it was really far away. And it's a forced perspective is what it's called. And, you know, it's you think, well, why didn't you just use the same Walker over and over again? Because you would have to have a room, say, this big, whereas if you did the other one, you'd only have to have the stage 10 feet deep. And real estate inside of a studio is, you know, per square foot. How much does it cost, and how much time are you going to be spending on your budget and all that stuff?
Well, I think we'll see that stage too.
So it's much easier.
Speaking of scale, this is kind of an interesting drawing that.
Oh
I
yeah.
I think you did. You do this? Yeah, it looks like your text.
Joe Johnston did it.
Oh.
But you're right. There's. Where's my button? Here we go. If this is the Princess's ship, the Rebel Blockade Runner, and that's also the Rebel Blockade Runner. So that's the scale of it is to the white, big white Star Destroyer. And then, of course, this is the scale that it is to the rest of them. So, you know, I think I one time calculated that the white Star Destroyer is about 3 miles long. So it's really big.
Sure looked like it in that initial shot from A New Hope where it's flying over you. It
was and also an interesting aside on that is, you know, there's a ray dome up there. Well, on the top of Mount Tam, especially when I got here, were two large ray domes. There's only one left. They were for the Nike missile base bases of the 50s. And there's ones in Hawaii, there's ones in the Southwest, and they all are about 80 feet in diameter. So I use that to calculate why it was 2.5 miles long or something like that.
So let's get into some models.
This is my friend described it as what's that stone that Napoleon found?
The Rosetta Stone.
Yeah, the Rosetta Stone to knowing the scale of the different ships is knowing that the ray dome is always 80 feet, approximately 80 feet.
Cool. So this model is one of my favorites.
This is one of the, it's a model that I sometimes call the, like the 3-day wonder, 4-day wonder, that kind of thing. It's, if you see it at a different angle, it's actually Standard Brand's paint buckets, those cardboard paint buckets. And somebody, they told me that, well, you need to do this, we need to have this model, it's used for only one shot, and we're gonna shoot it on Monday. So would you make that model, you know, and you, that's your budget, one person, actually somebody else helped me, but two people, 4 days, 5 days. And so I took two buckets and truncated one and put it on top of the other and filled it with foam and stripped the paper off and then put plastic on it. So, but if you look at the escape pod from certain angles, you can tell that it's the same size as a paint bucket.
Well, here we go. Here's paper, a scale for you.
Paper paint bucket. Yeah. And this was our second successful shot. We, believe it or not, the camera equipment and the computers and everything were all built on the premises. And I call them computers. They were like early 1977, 76, 77 computers. And they were, they basically put memory onto a tape. And you replayed the tape and that moved the cameras.
So this was the famous Dijkstra cam?
Yeah, the Dijkstra Flex. But we were having a hard time getting all the equipment done. And George Lucas was certainly frustrated that we weren't getting shots done. And so this shot and another shot were possible without any combination of piece of film. Everything was within the camera. And
there's a comment on one of the makings of reels where he says, it's been a year and I've only got 4 shots. I don't have anything. Because I guess you have to build the factory before you can build the...
have to build the factory, but it's hard to tell the money people that you know, you need to go to step 1, 2, 3, and 4. They want you to come up with the visuals very quickly, and so it's very frustrating. So
there's another shot of that.
Yeah.
So that had little latches in there to drop it.
Yeah. There's three solenoids, much like the solenoids in your washing machine when you hear it go clunk, you know, when it reaches another cycle, and there was a momentary switch that pulled these little things out, dropped it down into a big drape of black velvet. So you might or might not notice that there isn't a star field. It was just dropped into black velvet. And then I put mica dust where the little solenoids moved. And so when they move and they pop back, it makes this sparkly stuff as kind of a distraction and, you know, to show a little bit of action. So when you actually see the shot, that little sparkly thing flying around is mica dust.
Let's see the shot. Here we go.
Hey, you're not permitted in there. It's restricted. You'll be deactivated for sure. Don't you call me a mindless philosopher, you overweight glob of grease. Now come out before somebody sees you. Secret mission? What plans? What are you talking about? I'm not getting in there. I'm going to regret this.
Mica dust.
There goes another one.
Hold your fire. There's no life forms. It must have short-circuited.
I always love the classic lines that come from movies.
Yeah.
I'm going to regret this. It's become a classic line, I think.
Yeah. By the way, I had mica dust in about five different scales. So from really small to bigger than an eighth. So you would adjust, I used mica dust in all different kinds of shots, and you would adjust the size of the particles to fit the scale of whatever it is the shot was happening.
So moving on to the next, my favorite models is the Millennium Falcon. So here it is, kind of a really early stage.
Very early stage. And I don't know, that's me, by the way, but I looked different colored hair for sure, not gray at the time.
I tried to find as many shots of you as I could.
But yeah, that's the very, very beginning of the Millennium Falcon.
So this is a bigger one. There were different sizes,
yeah,
right?
Depending on which way you measure it, that was 4 feet or 5 feet if you measure the length. But we made them 4 feet, 2 feet, about 6 inches, and about 2.5 inches, very, very small. And again, you did that just so that if you knew that it was going to be on, well, we'll show you later on, but this is making of the two-footer. And there was really a fortunate thing is that when I put all the pieces together on the big four-footer, I was using a lot of Formula One cars from the mid-70s, and I just happened to use the larger scale. And years later, like 3 years, 2 years later or something like that, they said, well, now we need to build a much lighter one, a one-foot, and lo and behold, there were Formula One cars in a smaller scale. So it was exactly half scale, so I was able to actually put exactly the same pieces together. And the reason we did this was the big four-footer, four people had to lift it to get it onto the pylons and on the stage. It had these sticks that went in, the rods that went in. Well, when in Empire, when they do the going through the asteroid belt, you know, the all of this here, it has to do a lot of these flips. Well, if they used the four-footer, if you tried to, you know, you had to move it very, very slowly. Otherwise, it would go wrong, wrong, wrong. You know, it weighed so much. So one made out of aluminum weighed fractions of what the big one did. And so the cameraman could shoot it much quicker. They could have the model not just move at snail's pace, but, you know, a little bit faster. And time is money in every field. And, you know, the camera people wanted bright lights and as models moving as fast as possible so they could go on to another shot.
So I thought we'd get some detail in here so you can talk a little bit about the detail. So let's move in a little bit.
Yeah, the book that I wrote on the subject was going to be translated into Japanese, and so they had the Japanese writer call, get on the phone together, and I was telling him, oh, this is an example of how really obsessed a lot of people can be about Star Wars, is I was telling him that there was some Ferrari heads, you know, I can see where it is, and he said, you know, respectfully, Mr. Peterson, that is not a Ferrari, that is a Williams, you know, a car. He knew which Formula One cars, which engine parts were off of them, and he was right, you know. I was just, but at the time, I could tell you what Panzer tank from Germany, World War II, this part came from, and you know where that part and which Formula One suspension part this was and that kind of thing, but forget over the years.
Now these vents were actually vents. The vents were actually real vents.
Yeah,
because
there was halogen lights. And I think, one of the tip-off was I was talking of a 12-cylinder engine, and he obviously said, that's not a 12-cylinder engine. You know, it's at the time, Ferrari was 12 cylinders.
So you actually had to get heat out from this model. So you really did need actual vents. Kinda, I think that's kind of nice. Here's another kind of close-up.
Yeah.
Amazing detail. And since you were talking about model parts.
Oh, yeah. we could go to the wholesale place, and two of us would take a shopping cart. You know, they had shopping carts, and we'd just go through and get eight of these. And it's always even numbers, always 10 of something, 16 of something, two of something, you know, of all these model kits. And, you know, it was thousands of dollars of model kits, even if we got them for half price, you know. It was going through a warehouse. And then eventually it turned out that Tamiya and Hasegawa were the two best model companies, the best detail, two Japanese companies. And we got in touch with them, and they said, oh, we can just make you the trees that you want. And that's what they're called, as trees, when all the parts are still attached to the things. And they would send us a whole box full of this. This is from a German railgun called Karl, a huge, it was almost like shot small refrigerators from a railroad car. And the German engineers were always really incredible at being able to design and build engineering marvels, and still are.
So you're talking about the smallest Millennium Falcon.
Yeah, that was the smallest Millennium Falcon. So there's an interesting thing where, you know, I hired many different model makers over the years, and not every model maker is exactly the same. I used to describe it that some model makers are good at making something this big to something 5 feet, and some model makers are good at making something 1 inch to 8 inches, but they aren't the same people. Sometimes you need people to make something that's 25 feet. It's not the same model maker that makes things that are this size. You know, they're just a different breed, and you don't try to make somebody do something that doesn't exactly fit their skills.
You're looking at the
that's the really big one from the first show.
Can anybody spot Lorne?
Yeah. Second from the right. Yeah, that's the camera shooting the thing on. And the reason there's so many of us are we just lifted the thing and put it there. And you can see it's really cantilevered out there. So when something is cantilevered really far, its weight can bounce like that. So you only get to shoot it at a very low speed.
Everyone know where that shot is?
Yeah, the old docking bay.
So here's a sort of a pan through, so you can see the motion-controlled camera.
So, yeah, he has a device in his hands there, and he's programming the move. So it's almost like he has a steering wheel of several axes, and he's programming the shot, the way the camera will go. Because normally the camera does it by himself. There's nobody behind the camera when it actually runs the film through it.
So you probably want to see the shot, don't you?
Yeah.
Let's just see the shot. Pretty dramatic. Yeah.
Yeah, it looks pretty simple when you see it set up on the stage. It's just a couple of flat pieces with plastic parts and that kind of thing.
Yeah, I'm going to skip forward away from the Millennium Falcon for a moment because there's something important in this frame that you brought to ILM.
Yeah, the little red bottle there is a bottle of super glue, and I think it was called Zap at the time. And you couldn't... I had an industrial design background after college, and that's what I was working in, and did Yamaha snowmobiles and Onkyo turntable fronts and things like that, and you know, even down to porta potties. You know, the company that I was working for did porta potties or designed them. And
okay, that's a humble beginning.
Yeah, that's a humble beginning. And I just thought of that. I'd never had mentioned that to you before, but that was one of the things we did. But when I showed up at ILM, I was only hired for 2 months to do a difficult job. And I noticed that all the model makers were using 5-minute epoxy to apply the parts for, and then they'd put tape over them and then mix up some more 5-minute epoxy. And I thought, oh my God, this is gonna take them forever and ever to do that. And so since I could buy it, because we had it from my industrial design days, because you could buy it wholesale, but you couldn't buy it retail. And it was fairly more faster and more dangerous than super glue is even these days, although it's still dangerous. And so what I did was I brought a bottle in, maybe four mornings into it, and I told all the model makers, stop, I want to show you something. Everybody turn around this way. And I took a pencil, yellow pencil, and I put it at the edge of the table, put my finger in, I put a drop, and then took my hand away, and the pencil remained cantilevered out over the desk. And everybody was, oh, you know, how in the world did you do that, you know? And so it's, I mean, everybody in here would know what super glue is, but at one particular time, nobody knew what it was. And so it really changed the whole speed and process that we were able to make these models. You, as fast as you could put it on and put another part, so it really speeded things up. And no one ever mentioned that I was only hired for 2 months after 20 years and 40 years. They never mentioned
it. Who would have known?
Yeah.
I was a high school student when I started here. Yeah. Who would have known?
Yeah, who would have known?
I think we discovered super glue at the same time you guys did. It was Eastman 901, I think.
910.
910?
Okay. Yeah. Eastman
and 910. It held a lot of our exhibits together here.
Yeah.
Still does, actually.
Yeah.
The super glue gaffer's tape is very important.
The little red bottle was a retail stuff, but the original one was Eastman 910. And then within, you know, it seemed it was within months it was available in hobby shops.
Anyone want to know? Anyone guess what that model is? TIE Fighter.
TIE Fighter. Getting. Also, the models always, of course, they had lights on the inside and they had some electronics sometimes. So they had to have a loom, just like a loom is what's inside of a car for all the electrical system where all the wires go. So they had to be mounted from six different spots. So they all had to have plugs at six different places so that if you mounted it from the bottom or the top or the side, whatever, front and back, you could hook up the electrical part. And then the cooling many times, because they had halogen lights in them, they'd have to have cooling fans and that kind of stuff. So it tended to have an aluminum structure on the inside with wires, just like in the inside of a car, going to different places.
So I like this slide here because it shows that you molded a lot of the pieces as well, so you can make multiples.
There were two reasons. There were two types of molded parts. One was so that other cameramen, more than one cameraman, could have an X-wing, so you could have all during the evening, and you'd have three shifts, in other words, of cameramen, so they could have it on several stages. And then the other one, you made a whole bunch of ones for blowing up, because we blew up a lot of different models. And then it was working out what kind of a formula of the plastic, because a plastic you wanted that was brittle, because usually plastic is made so it's durable and it's not brittle and it doesn't fall apart. So then you have to figure out, well, how do you change the formula of the plastic so that it's weak and brittle so it will explode and explode into little tiny pieces.
So this is, I guess, a Y-wing.
Yeah, I think this one's rolling down on a wire, too, and then it explodes.
I think we have a shot of it,
don't you?
I did a little supercut of exploding things. This must be so painful. You don't have to watch this if you don't want.
Well, you know, actually,
shade your eyes.
Anybody that did a little pyro stuff when they were a kid, you know, actually enjoyed it. It was fun, and you know, and they paid you to make the parts and you know and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah, he's putting that weird clay stuff. He's putting the explosives underneath of the clay. Now, this would have been called an unsuccessful shot. You know, just have one wing pop off.
But this one wasn't.
That is a success. that's a successful shot. Yeah. Sometimes they would run the shots from underneath also so that all the parts didn't fall with gravity. But this shot would be cut long before you actually saw it like this.
Before you see the hang on the wires.
Hang on the wires, yeah.
So that motion control camera, which was...
Well, you can't have a motion control camera with explosives. You have to have a dolly and people pushing the dolly as fast as they can. You'll probably see that a little bit later. But the motion control is made, that camera only moves one frame, one frame, one frame, one frame. Very tick, 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 tick. No, that's even too fast. It's tick, 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 like that. But to do an explosion shot, you got to have the camera going at high speed and rushing towards the model. So usually it's like four guys pushing the camera on a dolly rig down a track.
So here's the motion control camera.
Yeah, and they all had these pylons that had neon on the inside, and they would glow, so they would have the right you could turn the glow up and down, so it'd blend in with the background. And that was what our computers looked like, but they had to be built from scratch. You couldn't buy a computer that did that kind of thing. And then IBM and people had big, huge computers that filled up rooms.
This was about the time of the beginning of personal computers, though, because I was going to Homebrew Computer Club back around those times, too. But nobody had the attachments for our computers that would do this.
Yeah, it seemed like ancient history now, doesn't it, that happened. I remember thinking that at some particular stage in the future, they're going to drag out onto a stage the widow of the last person that worked on Star Wars to tell that widow will tell, yes, he worked on Star Wars. Who knows what that person will be, you know? Who that person will be.
So, moving along. Yay, we're going to move to the battle cruisers.
Yeah.
So, tell us about these battle cruisers. They're huge.
Well, we always called this is the White Star Destroyer. It didn't have a name that showed up in the film. It was just the big White Star Destroyer or the small one. And by the way, the first Star Wars, the white one that heads overhead is only about 3.5 feet long. And the camera, there's a special lens called it with a tilting lens board that allowed you to turn the lens down, and it scraped the model by about 1/8 of an inch. It was almost touching the model. We had to worry a lot about that. And this is the one from Empire, and it's 8 feet. And it just was able to get more detail and all that kind of stuff. And then also have it on different stages with different cameramen running, because we eventually had to switch to three different shifts to be able to finish the movie on time.
And you worry about scraping them because they're not cheap.
It wasn't cheap. And I said this before, but you know, with time, people would ask, well, how much money did it cost to make those things, or how much were they worth? And, you know, money changes from 1978 to 2018. And so I would just say, well, this one's like a Toyota, and this one's like a used Toyota, and this one's like a inexpensive BMW, and that one's like a more expensive BMW, and that one's like a inexpensive Ferrari. So those, making one-off models that have to do all kinds of things and be usable for different camera shots and everything cost quite a bit of money and time. But that's only when last week we did Mustafar, didn't we?
Last month, yeah.
Yeah, and Mustafar, the big model of the lava planet, definitely was an expensive Ferrari.
Yeah. Was this just a used Ferrari?
Yeah, and no, this would have been on the expensive side of BMW. At that time, especially.
Let's get a closer shot, because the details on these things is amazing.
Maybe a medium-priced BMW now.
Lorne was nice enough to take a couple of us up to the archive up at the ranch, and we got a chance to take a look at these things close up, and it doesn't make any difference how close you get. The detail was always there. It was just absolutely incredible.
This particular model was lit with fiber optics, too. I think we have a shot here of, he's repairing the fiber optics right now. But
here's a shot of the fiber optics.
Yeah, can you see? Yeah, you can see those little black glass rods coming out of there. And I think, you know, there were tens of thousands of them on this model. And you'd eventually snip them off, you'd run them, drill a hole, run them off, and then you'd take a heat gun or a soldering iron and mushroom the end of the fiber optic. And then you could see
optics.
It from different angles.
You'd have to do each one of those fiber optics individually.
Yeah, you had to do each of them. And I think sometimes when they're back in there, we took a soldering iron, and you just get the soldering iron close, and then plastic mushrooms. If you don't mushroom it, the light is only really directional, like this, where when you mushroom it, you can see it from several sides.
Here's a little bit more advanced one.
Yeah, this was the beginning of the Executor or Darth Vader ship, that blue ship. And, you know, there are 1,000 stories, so you know, sometimes we don't know if we have the time to tell them all. But there's an interesting thing here where I was told that George Lucas wanted to have Darth Vader have his own special ship that would be this kind of a blue-gray color. And they said, well, just paint the white Star Destroyer blue, and we'll shoot it, and then paint it back white for the rest of the shots. And I was like, oh, my God. You know, all the fiber optics would have had to have been scraped, tens of thousands of them, and then the other cameraman wouldn't have been able to use it. So I said, we can't do that. We just can't. And they said, well, come up with some kind of proposal for what we could do. So we came up with this. The art director drew up a drawing, and we proposed this long, narrow ship that was much longer. And they said, oh, okay, we'll buy that. And then I said, well, you know, it's going to cost this amount of money. And they said, well, the most important thing is that it's be available in 8 weeks. And I was like, 8 weeks, you know? They said, yeah, it's already scheduled to be shot. And we figured you could just paint it blue and shoot it in 8 weeks, and it would be no problem. But now that you say that you have to make a whole model, you still have to make it in 8 weeks. So we had to work, you know, many times. One of the guys registered 80 hours 1 week.
That's a lot of hours.
On his time card.
But this one didn't have fiber optics.
No, it had a neon in it. And we knew that, you know, just like when you fly over L.A., you know it's a really big city because there's lots of lights. If you fly over Phoenix, you know that it's a more medium-sized city from the lights, et cetera, et cetera. So we knew that it had to have many thousands of times more lights to suggest that it was many, many times. It's like about 10 times longer than a white Star Destroyer. So we had miniature neon put in, and then we took, we sent out to an outside vendor. We had brass, a very thin brass etched with all these little holes, and then you make like a little building around the neon, and so then it shows that you have thousands and thousands of lights that we never could have done had we drilled it.
So there's the kind of the result.
Yeah. And you can also, you may or may not see, but the ray dome on the very top is the same size, in theory, it's the same size as the ray dome on the white Star Destroyer.
80 feet, right?
Yeah, the white Star Destroyer would be about that long. So this is much, much longer than.
So the nice thing about, I think, about the lighting for this was that not only did it have the windows, but also gave a general glow if you looked at the thing. And here's this nice slide showing you kind of the general glow as well. Just beautifully done.
I don't know if any of you have seen, but there's a little Lego movie of Darth Vader going down to the cantina, you know, in the Death Star or the White Star Destroyer, and he's saying, there has to be a cantina with that many people. And so he's getting his penne arrabbiata, you know, and with his tray, and it's a very funny.
For anyone who wants to look that up, it's Eddie Izzard did a routine about that. So look up Eddie Izzard.
It's very, very funny.
Star Wars. So not only did you work on ships, but you worked on small models of, like R2-D2. I mean, C-3PO here.
Yeah, this was for the shot where they're heading to Mos Eisley, and the speeder goes overhead, and so it's seen only from behind. So I only had to make, I used the $6 million man, and then trimmed him down to make C-3PO.
You mean you used the action figure of the $6 million man?
Yeah, that's what it is. And you can't see it here, but close enough. He has one eye that's good and the other one's glass, kind of a thing. And then later on, I made the smaller one. And the reason was, again, I come back to that thing. The cameraman wanted to do more shots. And if you have to do it far away, because when the Tusken Raiders are shooting at it, it's real small, which means you have to put that model way, way far away. And they don't want to use up stage space, so they just say, well, make a small one, and we'll make a little 8-foot arc and shoot it that way.
Is there any coincidence, the fact that the kid in this shot looks like Indiana Jones?
Yeah, it was somebody, I don't know whose kid it was, and, you know, not an awful lot of people that were in their 20s had kids, so it might have been somebody from the outside, a friend of a
neighbor
friend.
Neighbor kid or something.
Yeah, a friend of a friend's.
So here's
like
here's the full version of the land speeder.
Yeah,
this one you could
size.
Actually drive.
Yeah, it had a little British car called a Reliant, a three-wheeled car. And, Yeah, the British after World War II made a lot of, or even before, made a lot of three-wheel cars. And I don't know if you know it, but the reason for it is that in Europe you would be taxed more for a four-wheel car, and a three-wheel car is only would only be taxed as a motorcycle. So someone who wanted to save money or didn't have an awful lot of money could buy a three-wheeled car at and pay much less tax.
So here it is sitting out on the desert. But
now, also, there's a mirror. You can see that mirror is attached there, and it's put at an angle so that it shows sand. So when the vehicle is actually driving in the desert, you don't actually see the wheels.
This
moving.
Is so clever.
Makes it look like it's floating.
If you look, if you put your eyes up here somewhere, that disappears.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you have some running footage too.
This is off in the distance.
Yeah.
Yeah, and this is a little bit of footage from the making of, so it's really lousy, but.
Yeah, you can see how well it actually works. And then somebody had to animate the shadow underneath of the car, too. So it's an animated shadow.
So not all of them were actual cars.
Yeah, sometimes it was out on a large cantilever, so it could only go in a circle. But it's amazing how well it works, you know, when you cut the different elements together.
When you cut it together, it looks like this.
If they trace the robots,
and that sandcrawler is real size. That's not a matte painting back there.
Home.
Oh, wait,
it's actually a set.
It's too dangerous.
This is that moment that you, like every boy and girl, when your parents have said, or your aunt and uncle in his case, have said, stay on the farm, just go to a junior college close by, and you get to the homestead and you go, college in the big city. Yeah. I have a role to play in the with the rebels, you know. I'm sure he didn't think of it that way, but you know, I sometimes saw the film that way, that it's young people realizing, like, I have something to do in the big world, even though my mom and dad say, you know, why don't you stay close to home and get a job in the stationery store and that kind of thing.
I always thought that one big jet engine right behind his head was a really bad idea.
Yeah.
So some of the things you built were not for human being costumes for human beings either, and I just love this shot.
Yeah, because what in the world was that thing?
Yeah, what was that thing?
And you have to know that those costumes were made in England. I didn't.
Oh, you didn't have to do that.
Didn't have anything.
Okay,
with
I
that.
Wanted to show this. So. Because I love this. This slide was in your collection. I just love this slide. But there you can see even the elephants got costumes.
Yeah, you pointed out that they had to train the elephant to keep his trunk curled up so it wouldn't show, too.
Yeah, they had the trunk curled up in their mouth.
What a patient elephant.
Really. Okay, back to your models.
Yeah, this was the sandcrawler. We had taken a Tamiya tank. There was a plastic and metal tank that was really big. It was very expensive at the time, too. And then we modified the treads and motorized it and did all that kind of stuff. It had four of these tanks in it, and you could actually sit on top of it with a controller and drive yourself around the room. It was very strong. That was at the very beginning when it just had wooden panels.
And you're not going to like this shot, but I threw it in anyway.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because you built that back end.
Yeah, you can tell the guy with the Puma shirt.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was one of the things where they started, you know, they said, well, how about you do the engine first, you know, and so I'd do that, and they really liked that. And this is like the very beginning, you know, maybe I was wondering whether or not I was going to be more than 2 months at the time. But the back end of the thing is there's a plane called a Hawker Harrier, a British vertical takeoff plane. And those parts, there's an awful lot of Hawker Harrier parts. These kind of things were the direction of the jet blast to allow the plane to take off vertically.
Just the detail is amazing. And you tried to make the detail so it was consistent.
Yeah, it's...
Pipes didn't just end.
Yeah, the one thing that we were thinking of, we were always trying to think of it's use what called boilerplate technology. You know, you can't make a ship out of just one piece of steel, like a battleship. You have to do it in different parts. And especially long ago, 100 years ago, they used big rivets. So we tried to have rivets. We tried to and it had to look, we set this goal for ourselves that it had to look functional. So if a tube went, if a tube left somewhere, it had to go to somewhere, as if it was connected to a carburetor, or if it was connected to some plenum, or you know, something like that. So we noticed in the film 2001, when the ship went overhead, if you stopped and just had a still, many of the pipes and tubes didn't go anywhere. And it worked perfectly fine in 2001, but we just thought, you know, it would actually be more genuine if it really looked totally functional, so that no one would ever have any doubt that it was a real motor back there of some futuristic or previous design.
So I think the next slide is actually from the remake, but...
Yeah, the first one was the first Star Wars, and we went out in the desert and dug a hole and put the camera down really low, and then drove the sandcrawler up over a small 8-inch little sand dune or something. And then by the time we did the re-release, I had gray hair by that time, and we just did it on the top of the roof of our building, and then we carved, I carved the rocks and set it up, and it worked real well. George wanted it much more dynamic shot. The first show, it kind of comes at a distance but never gets to you, and then in the re-release, it actually comes up and almost goes over the top of you.
So here's the re-release, and I apologize. This is dark enough that it doesn't work well in projection, but go home and look at your DVDs or your Blu-rays.
Oh, because of the lights and everything.
R2-D2, it is you! It is you!
I never realized that C-3PO actually blinks until I saw that segment right there.
Yeah, this was in a place called Randsburg in the near Death Valley, and this is on top of the roof. And the clouds were just perfect at the time when they just formed, you know, within a couple of hours when we were doing the shot.
But there you can see what you were talking about putting it together with plates of steel.
Yeah, it isn't just one big giant piece. So how did they make this thing? The previous shot too, you don't have to go back to it, but it was at Randsburg. And they had done a lot of mining there by hydraulic mining. I forget that's placer mining something. And what they do is they just take big hoses and they go at the hills and they wash away the stuff and they silt it, find gold. And so they, 100 years ago, they'd build up these giant piles of silt. And then, of course, in subsequent years, the desert would dry it out and the rains would come. And it wore it just like the Grand Canyon, miniature version of Grand Canyon and canyons. And so we were able to take it out there and run it at dusk, and it looked pretty genuine.
So I want to switch to a little tiny model that actually gets quite a bit of screen time. It's amazing because some of these models you build, they get like 7 seconds of screen time. But this model here, it's hard to see in this thing. It's just a little sphere.
The fencing droid.
The fencing droid, yeah. You see how it's operated? It's not computer run.
It was supposed to be run by a motor, and then they decided, it was much better to kind of have an individual person, the art director in this case, run it, and then they matched it up with the fencing of Luke. And if you look closely, you can see that there are truck rims, chromed truck rims. Wherever the laser comes out, off of a fairly large scale, like Mack truck or something.
I thought they were rhinestones when I first looked at it.
No, it has retroreflective tape in each of the little holes where the rims are, too. So it glows back at the camera. There's a small light at the side of the camera.
See? You can do it.
So, Death Star.
Yeah, this is one of the scales. There were about, I think, 3 or 4 scales of Death Star. And this is the very high elevation. And we'd taken Death Star pieces of a different scale, photographed them from up high, over and over, well, not over and over again, we printed them over and over again, and then made a mosaic of it, making sure that the shadow line was the correct direction, and then put it over curved masonite. And then Randy in the background is putting small little towers on there. And this was, I think you have running footage for this too, when the transition from one different scale of Death Star. It's usually a flash of laser that up in Luke's face and
right.
Flashes out, and then they switch to another scale.
So I think the next scale, so this is the furthest scale, and I think this is the next closest
scale. That's a pretty large scale.
Yeah.
That one is. So that's further away.
So there you can see they're pushing the camera, the dolly.
Yeah, the guy is running, actually. And this is a smaller scale, yet a smaller scale. Again, he's on a dolly. And then this is back to the large scale, I think. And there's a wire. The camera is being let loose. You can see this big parabola of wire right there. The camera is about in here. And this guy over here is pulling on this rope that makes sure that the camera doesn't hit the Death Star. He pulls up on it and takes a little bit of slack out of the parabola. But
so the camera is kind of sliding down this wire?
Yeah, the camera is just sliding from the guy let it go up there. He's ducking because of the explosion. And then it goes down this thing, and it makes it look like a run on the Death Star.
So that kind of looked like this in the movie.
Get set up for your attack run!
And, yeah, they keep getting bigger and bigger scale. Then he gets down in the trench, and it's the biggest scale.
So here's a...
We did a lot of things out in the parking lot, too. And, you know, I'm sure our neighbors, not knowing... Well, they eventually knew that we were making a movie, but I'm sure it was quite puzzling to them to see what we blew up out in the parking lot.
So I think this is the larger scale one, because look at the detail on this.
Yeah, the larger scale.
Yeah, and so here the camera, again, is... moving across this model and kind of knocks a piece of it off, I noticed. But here, I think the camera, I think this was a mistrigger. Well, that's outside. Yeah. The camera was on the truck. So here, the explosion occurs behind the camera. This must have been a misshot.
This was a mistake. It wouldn't have been right. You know, see, the camera's already passed and the explosion goes off.
And then they call Lorne up to rebuild the model.
Yeah. Well, that would be pyro people's fault.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
They have to rebuild the model?
No. We had to rebuild the model, but it was pyro's fault. And, you know, in all those years, no one ever lost a finger or lost an eye or, you know, there were certainly stitches. And I got super glue in my eyes 3 times and glued an eye shut and had to pry it open, you know.
Oof. So my favorite part of the Death Star, and this was a shot that I had never seen before. I got to go through all of his pictures. It was really great. But I've never seen this picture of the trench, the Death Star trench, that they fly the camera down. It's like really dramatic. I mean, that's a really big model.
It means they could do it. They could do a long shot, and then they could give it to the editors, and they would just splice it wherever they wanted to for the length of the shot.
There's a shot looking down the trench. And then I found
my very first job was, and why it was an undesirable job, that is we had to wear these big foam pads on our knees and crawl in there and make all the little retroreflective lights. There were thousands of them, and we'd spend the whole day crawling on your knees, me and this other guy, and attaching wherever you, and you can't much see it in here, but when you see the film, there's little tiny, something like a 16th inch by 16th inch of the retroreflective tape, much like appears on your license plate, you know, when the headlights hit your license plate from behind and they glow. But after that was finished, I kind of proved myself in other fields.
So here's this is an overexposed shot because I think it was for the mat of running down that really long trench.
Yeah.
And I did make a trench, because you have to see it from the movie, too. This is sort of my trench supercut. It does not occur in the movie like this.
Luke, at that speed, will you be able to pull out in time?
It's just like Beggar's Canyon.
So it changes from that high-up view. Watch, right there.
That was the first successful shot right there.
Ever. This is almost all the trench shots in A New Hope.
You know, when a shot like this, the way that we would see it many times, didn't have music and it didn't have sound effects and it didn't have dialogue, and they can seem pretty mundane when you see them that way.
Look out!
The director really kind of has to have a vision that all those elements are going to come together and make a good movie. But sometimes when you just see them broken down into elements, they can be... Yeah, you wonder...
Sorry. Spoiler. I can't do that. That'd be a spoiler alert.
How did Luke get a rocket that turned right angles?
I don't know. It's a cruise missile.
Right.
So Lorne actually appeared in the movie, and you might recognize him from this shot here.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Lorne.
This was in Guatemala. George saw a National Geographic magazine that had the temples like he wanted out in the jungle. And the studios said, well, why don't you just use Disneyland and Adventureland? And of course, George said, well, you get up high, the shot, you see the parking lot, you know. And so the studios finally relented in the money, but they only sent two people. They would only pay for two people. So I could speak a little bit of Spanish, and so I volunteered to go and all that stuff. And then I became the guy in the tower because I was the only one that didn't have children. And there was about 300 feet drop off the far side. And we only had permission from the Guatemalan government to put pound three pitons into the temple. So if you wanted to be really safe, maybe you'd have like eight pitons with cables, you know, to make it really, because it wobbled. You'd have to, when they did the shot, you'd have to stand really still for a while so the wobble would come out of the tower.
So you know that everyone wondered what happened to that guy, and somebody actually did a little spoof on it.
Oh,
so
yeah, what if
Rogue
they...
One.
Well, they tell you here.
Movie, the Obi-Wan movie, the Boba Fett movie, and Star Wars Episode 1 to 23 comes now, the long-awaited story of that one rebel guy from Yavin 4.
Oh, just a one breath.
Hopefully everybody can hear it.
What am I looking out for exactly? Guys?
A man left on his own.
Bit high up. I'm seeing a spaceship! There is a spaceship coming towards us!
Oh, you already had that on your radar for 2 hours. All right, perfect. Great. You already hung up. I'm just talking to myself.
This December.
Hello. Yeah. I'm calling again because of the ladder I ordered. Yeah, no, it didn't arrive yet. No. F***ing kidding me.
The absolute last remaining story of the saga will be told.
What? We won? Awesome! Oh, no, everything was going pretty well over here with me. No, this morning it was really weird for a second because it was...
That one rebel guy you briefly see on Yavin 4, a Star Wars story. In
theaters, so that would be
December
the last Star Wars movie ever. The 23rd, was it? 23rd episode.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I had to insert that. It was...
It showed up on the computer like 3 weeks ago.
Boy, are we behind schedule. Okay. Moving on. We're now at the second movie.
The
Tauntaun. This is going to last for 3 hours.
The one on the right is a stop-motion puppet about this big. And then in Norway, they, of course, used the head of Luke and the head of the Tauntaun for a close-up shot. But this is what it looks like on the snowfields in Norway, Finnsay, Norway.
This is beautiful.
Little stop motion puppet.
Really makes me admire all the Harryhausen stop motion.
You can see that's the close up of Luke and the full size Tauntaun.
And then, of course, Luke gets to meet the Wampa.
Yeah, this is what the artwork would look like, storyboards, that kind of thing, of what the Wampa would look like. And at one time in Norway, they tried to have a guy in stilts with this big suit and fitting the scale of Luke. And then later on, we made it as a suit inside of a bunch of stalactites. And a guy named Howie really loved being the Wampa. He was also one of the Scolari brothers in Batteries. I mean, not Batteries Not Included. It was in Ghostbusters.
There
you start to
practicing.
Lose track of what film we. Yeah, see, here on the right-hand side, too, is the suit in Norway.
Left-hand.
They helped to have this guy on stilts or big boots, and it didn't work. He fell over. And so eventually they asked us in Marin to do it as a puppet, a hand puppet. Yeah, and here's the guy practicing on his stilt shoes in the snow, trying to walk, and then you have some running footage, right, of...
Yeah, very difficult to do. I took out the stupid sound effects. I felt sorry. I just felt sorry for the guy. It's bad enough. He doesn't need stupid sound effects to go along with him. Poor guy.
Yeah. And this is why we got a call that said, would you please do that shot, Ed?
And why this guy, Howie, isn't this his car?
Yes, it is. He was the Wampa. And you think that they would have figured it out in London by having that guy in the suit and just walking on flat floor that it would be really difficult to do, but they actually built the whole suit and then shipped it to Norway and had him try to walk in snow, which would be that much harder. But that's, making a film goes in fits and starts sometimes, and that was one of the fits.
We promised that we'd go on to the Imperial Walkers.
Yeah.
So.
This is Ralph McQuarrie, and this is the concept art is shown to George at the very first stage like this. There's a script, and the concept artist talks to George Lucas, does these little paintings, and George has kind of a thumbs up, thumbs down as to whether or not that is his vision of what it should look like.
Doesn't he have a rubber stamp that says Fabuloso?
He does. He had a red stamp, and if he really likes something, it would say Fabuloso printed on the thing. Yeah, and this is what a walker looks like on the inside. The machinists had to very precisely machine all these parts so that they could have Allen bolts and friction joints so that it could be a stop-motion puppet.
Quite a few of them.
Quite a few of them, yeah.
And you were mentioning the small one that was meant to be seen off in the distance.
Yeah, off in the distance sometimes it'd be a very, very small one. And there was actually one that had a little wire that his leg would move just a little bit. And I was trying to figure out which one this is, and I think it's this hand is actually far behind. I think it's actually a stop motion one in which the foot is much closer to the camera than you think.
Is this, so this may be the... It's 4 foot tall one, or the one that's stamped on top of the.
I think it's it's probably the 4 foot tall one.
So how do they position them?
Yeah, this was a field of baking soda, and then we had to make these trap doors so that the stop motion animators could pop up, as they did here, and they have height gauges to measure the movement. They have to move it just a little bit for the next frame and the next frame. And so they spend many hour popping up and out of these doors. And then they stay down there, and then when it's lunchtime, you get a little cart, you push a thing and put a sandwich to them, and then come back. And it's so that they don't lose their concentration. You're not supposed to talk to them when they're doing this. And they just
have to remember what moves they were doing.
Yeah, yeah.
So you were mentioning that these sets were only like 10 feet long.
Yeah, the set, it's a painting. A large painting in the background that one of the guys, painters did, and then a snow set with baking soda, and then a flat area with the baking soda, and then these passageways for the guys to go. And that table, they screw the feet down to the table from underneath. This is a bigger version. I mentioned that when you do explosions and things like that, you have to, if you try to use a small model with explosions, you can only get an explosion so small.
Doesn't scale correctly.
Much better to have a larger model.
Doesn't scale correctly.
Yeah, to get the scale correctly. The bigger the model, the better the explosion looks.
So here we made
a 4 foot version.
Here's the Imperial Walkers.
Activate harpoon! Good shot, Jansen!
That's all stop motion, though.
Yeah, and stop motion, but then, of course, it's an element of the speeder. And then when you reach the stage where it actually trips it, I had to figure out how to do that. And I went and got underwear, black underwear elastic from the store, and we wrapped that around it so that the feet could still move there with a little bit with the elastic. And then
I love this shot for all the stuff that rains down into the snow.
Yeah, a lot of shrapnel comes down into the snow.
Beautiful.
Into the baking soda, actually.
I think Luke needs to take lock picking courses, because the lightsaber is very inelegant to open that door right here.
Yeah. It's very awkward when you see it this way, of him on one thing dangling down.
So this is kind of a famous shot there.
Oh.
That back leg is a little awkward. It pops out there.
A little bit. So there's that. I think that may, you think that may have been the one he was working on?
Yeah, then we had to make a really big foot that would crush the lead speeder in the snow. It was actually made out of lead and tin, so that it would actually crush like a can.
I'm sorry, this was a little out of place, but because I wanted to do this shot here of the...
This is the one where the shot goes wrong, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It doesn't and always go right, as you can see.
Yeah, the head blew off too quickly, and then it sat down like a puppy dog. And every once in a while, things do go wrong.
It's kind of fun. You learn things, right? You learn things when they go wrong.
Yeah, you learn.
So now we can move on to...
Yeah, we're going to get to running footage of the asteroid belt, and here's one of the ones I saved out of the dumpster. And we had to make zillions of these asteroids for the asteroid belt.
Okay, so everyone, look at that asteroid. See if you can identify that asteroid when we come up to the. So this is just a little blue screen shot here that just actually just runs over and over and over again. Just give you an idea. They have to do each individual asteroid, and then composite them all into the movie. And here's the movie.
What are you doing? You're not actually going into an asteroid field.
They'd be crazy to follow us, wouldn't they?
This was the reason we had to have the 2-foot Millennium Falcon so that it could do those little sweeping motions.
Never tell me the odds.
Yeah, the asteroid varied from about 3 feet down to about 1 inch.
I like the pebbles pelting the Millennium Falcon.
I take it back. We're going to get pulverized if we stay out here much longer.
You can argue with that.
So where did they land?
Inside the space slug.
Inside the space slug. And here's Lorne working on the space slug rib.
Yeah, the teeth were on a hinge thing so he could motorize it, move it up and down. And there I am. I'm making the gums for the teeth.
And the throat, or the esophagus,
the throat or the esophagus. And it was, this is the actual surface of the asteroid where they come out of the tunnel.
So it's all carved out of foam.
Yeah. Yeah, we used thousands and thousands of dollars of foam over the years.
And the scene.
You know, you have to think, too, that they're actually acting like this, because the set is not rocking back and forth. It's the camera that's rocking back and forth. So they did a pretty good job of making it look like they were really bouncing around.
I don't think it's
time to discuss this committee.
Ooh, I am not a committee.
Carrie.
You can't make the jug of ice beat this asteroid field.
Sound, sweetheart, we're taking off.
No.
I see it.
We do. The cave is collapsing.
No cave.
What?
Like dental floss, they went right between the teeth.
are a space slug. There's the actual scale for it for us.
It was like a big hand puppet, and it had a like a trigger mechanism so you could move the mouth open and closed.
So you were talking about those domes, those radomes.
Yeah, the radomes. And this was, I think, the largest detail of the White Star Destroyer that we did. And it was for the scene where they hide on the back of the conning tower. The 2 foot one had to be able to be mounted on the back side. And the reason we had that little 2 inch one was to be able to mount it onto the White Star Destroyer for a more distant shot.
So here's the all this work, all that huge model. 1001, 1002, 1003, 1004. About 5 seconds worth of film.
5 seconds.
It's amazing. And sometimes
you would, you'd want to balance the cost of the model for the length of time it was used in the shot. But every once in a while, the director made the decision that, no, we'll make a very expensive model that will be only used for 5 seconds.
And you may have filmed it for a lot more than 5 seconds, but they only got, it was edited to this,
Yeah.
Recognize the ship?
Yeah, Slave One.
And we're finally getting to Return of the Jedi, because we're way over time right now. This shot, I don't think, is specifically from Return of the Jedi, but just to see the fleet of R2-D2s, I think, was really...
And some of them had certain special things that they could do. You couldn't get every R2-D2 to do all of the things he had to do, so you'd have more than one that did, special walked, and the other one had its foot kick out, and that kind of stuff.
We got really lucky when Lauren took us up to the archive. Excuse me. Disney was up there.
Get some water.
Disney was up there measuring them, so the entire fleet of R2-D2s were out. It was really great. And which one was Kenny Baker in? Well, they said, oh, it's that one right there. So the
Now this is a prototype of the shot of the speeder bikes in the forest, and we set it up with like Barbie dolls and little speeder bikes that we made and ran through. The forest was actually from E.T. We'd saved it, and I think you have running footage of the shot, too, don't you?
So this is kind of like the VHS previz shot.
Yeah. It's a proof of concept kind of little piece of film.
I just love this.
And the movie came out very much like this, you know? There's somebody going like that to blow the smoke out the back side.
So here's the real one. This was a time lapse of walking through the redwoods, right? With
yeah,
a steady cam.
They were following a very small little line with a steady cam.
That's going to leave a mark.
Yeah.
There's the blue screen.
Yeah, we'd have the actors. We did it in San Rafael, and the actors would come and do this kind of things on front of the blue screen.
So now we're getting back to the Death Star Mark II.
Yeah. It was George Lucas wanted an incompleted Death Star for when he brought it back, and so we had to do a lot of etched brass metal and everything like that to get the really fine detail inside the cavities that were not yet completed.
It's just a half. It's not a full star. It's not a sphere. It's a half sphere.
Yeah.
Secret ingredients.
What's that?
Secret ingredients. Super glue up there.
Oh, yeah. And the Ewoks had to fly and, to battle the bad guys.
And, of course, the chicken walker.
And this is the, you'll see the running footage of it. It's the hill where the Ewoks run the logs down. They crush the head, and then they run a bunch of logs down and causes the...
I thought the detail here is incredible. There were people inside of the chicken walker. You never saw them.
We were worried that if the head got crushed and it was revealed, that there wouldn't be any pilots on the inside, so we made miniature pilots, and one was George Lucas and one was the director.
Oh.
And somebody even sculpted them so they looked a little bit like those two characters.
But there was, I mean, even the console there had lights on it. I mean,
this was made out of we plated nickel to make it so that it would crush like a can instead of being crushed like plastic. Because if you go to crush something that's plastic, it just bounces back. Whereas we wanted it to crush like it was a vehicle. So we made the thing in plastic and then sent it to a company to get it nickel plated. And then we used acetone to clear out the plastic on the inside, so it made a very thin membrane of nickel.
And here's the footage. Oh. I went through these frame by frame to see if I could see the guys on the inside, and I could not. So that's just composited in over the logs, I think. Blowing up these models just so breaks my heart.
Yeah.
Speaking of models, this shot here, there's the dome that does blow up.
Yeah, because the dome, it was used in another shot where again, we had to make it out of more brittle material and blow up the ray dome.
Here it is here. And there's the Darth Vader's dark blue. There's the shot.
Sir, we've lost our bridge deflector shield.
So now when we were up in the archive, you showed us a model that you made for the field generators that are there in the back. You'll see them closer up in a shot coming up here. I'm going to quiz the audience here.
Come on. Come on.
By the way, listen to the scream here. We'll talk about that. But those field generators are actually pretty small. You had to build these like really, really, really quick, right?
It had to be done. It was done in a day. It was a very quick
Anyone
model.
Recognize what those things are? Let's turn it over. Recognize them?
Yeah, when somebody says make a model in a day, you know, then you have to find what you can get. And so it was made out of Dixie cups.
So that scream, which is in every Star Wars film, is called the Wilhelm, by the way. It was first seen in this film right here, which was Distant Drums, 1951.
Is it Gary Cooper in the hat, or not that one, but the hero?
There's the Wilhelm. And we saw it. We saw it again here.
It's the same scream that you, especially in the films of the 50s and the 60s, they always just use that same scream.
Star Wars, New Hope. Listen for the scream. The Wilhelm. Okay. We've got to wrap up here. So I just love this shot of the field generator on the surface of Endor with the guys standing there in the forest.
There's a lot of little miniature trees that I got from an architectural company. And in the foreground, it's on a plate. The painting is on a plate of glass. Those trees in the very foreground are just paint on glass. And then model trees about this high. And then a radar dish that I basically made it like an umbrella, but I knew that if it just blew up underneath, it would just blow the umbrella away. And so it's made like a kite also, so that it's tissue paper, painted tissue paper between a thin frame. And then there's little cables that keep the thing down on the ground so it doesn't just blow into the distance.
So you said you rented all those trees.
Yeah.
And thinking that you'd be able to return them after.
Yeah, there's a million stories everywhere, but everything has a budget. And so I said, what I'll do is I'll go over to this architectural model place and I'll talk to them about these trees. And I said, well, how about if I, instead of buying 1,000 of them, I rent 1,000 of them. And I will then give them back to you afterwards because most of them will survive. And say if they were going to charge $6 a piece for them, I'd say, well, how about I rent them for $3, and yet you get to get them back, and you can now sell them again for $8. And they thought, oh, that's a great idea. But the pyro guys had a different idea. And so they had told me it was going to be kind of a small, controlled explosion. And you can see what happens here. It's, there was absolutely, since the trees were made partly with spray glue, there was no chance. I didn't get to bring any of the trees back. So I had to return and pay full price for the $8 tree.
And here's the shot from the movie. This is one of the more beautiful explosions, I think.
Yeah, a lot of little good spinning things through the air.
So that is all we can do. I have time. We are already 22 minutes over. Next month, January 21st at 2 p.m., going to do all of his other movies, Poltergeist to Pirates of the Caribbean.
Not all of them, but about of them. Seven or eight.
Yeah, another 6-hour talk. So we hope you'll be able to come back for that next month.
Bring a sandwich with you.
Yes.
And
better bring dinner. thank you for coming.
Yeah, thank you.